Good afternoon, Keshri sir, Dr. Keshri sir.
Good afternoon.
I am Bhupen Deshmukh. Sir, welcome to all participants again. Moving on the session two of day one, topic of the session is electrical vehicle charging. I am happy to introduce today eminent speaker, Dr. Ritesh Kumar Keshri sir. He is currently working as Associate Professor, Department of Electrical Engineering, Visveshwaraiya, National Institute of Technology, Nagpur, India. He has completed PhD on Electrical Vehicle Propulsion System 2014, Department of Industrial Engineering, University of Padova, Italy, with enormous mundus fellowship under willpower from European Union 2014. M.Tech from NIT Jamshedpur, India in 2007. He has senior member IEEE and member of SAE India. He is also a reviewer in many pre-reviewed journal. He has publication in various journal with a citation of around 292 and also a patent file on hybrid control of resonant converter for DC grid applications. We are happy to have you with us, sir. Now I requested sir to please start the session.
Okay, thank you sir for my introduction. And so before starting with the audience, I want to request you that please feel free to ask me the questions about the presentation. And because for just so as to avoid any multiple queries at the same time, session is unmuted for the audience. But keep your questions at the end. We will be discussing and we will be addressing each and every question. And so please feel free to ask me any question which is related, and I will try my best to answer you. Okay, let's start our discussion. Okay. So today's discussion, what I'm going to make with you is about electric vehicle subsystems and the charging system. Main focus for us today will be a discussion on the charging system. And but for the sake of completeness of the topic, first I will explain you about the electric vehicle, what are the different subsystems of an electric vehicle, and then we will continue to the charging system. Okay. And during our discussion, I will also discuss with you what are the possible problems which are associated with the charging system. So one by one, I will try my best to explain you. And so let's start. So it is first good to understand what exactly is electric mobility. And then because we talk about the e-mobility when we talk about the electric vehicle system. So basically e-mobility is concerned with the onboard power electronic system. And the drive system of a vehicle and its interface with the grid and or interface with the grid, this grid and other connected vehicles for energy exchange. Important is that here, first thing is that we are talking about electric vehicles. So definitely we have some onboard energy sources available. Okay. And because our objective is to have a motion control. We want that mobility. So role of the power electronic system which is on board is to convert the available onboard DC supply to the required form of the electrical energy. It could be AC or it could be DC depending upon which type of motor you are going to. But the objective will be to impart a create such a situation that we will be able to ensure variable speed drive. Okay. Then second thing is because we have on the vehicle we have only onboard DC source which has limited supply, limited charge available. Once you run your vehicle, you are going to your charge is going to reduce. So under such a situation, what will happen that once it is finished or go below a particular level, you have to again charge your vehicle, means regain your charge. So from where you are going to regain the charge, only mean is that. You are having a grid, Okay, this is a grid, and this grid could be that the conventional grid, or it could be a photovoltaic PV fed grid. Okay, a conventional grid means like we have that will be fed by thermal power plants, hydroelectric power plants, maybe the nuclear power plants. Okay, and when we are talking about the dedicated grid for the charging station, it could be a PV fed grid, or it could be a grid which is being fed by the fuel cells. But remember that such type of capability of such type of grid, or maybe like 10 kilowatt, 20 kilowatt, in some cases it can go to 50 kilowatt also. Okay, then the second term you are seeing here, that we talk about that interface circuit which is there with the other vehicles also. Okay, this is the other connected vehicles. What is the purpose basically? Maybe at present this concept is not being used, but very soon we will be seeing on the road that such type of connections, vehicle to vehicle energy exchange, will be. Simple meaning is that you are going on the way, and due to some reason you finished your charge. So there's like still that next charging station is quite far, and you are not able to reach that charging station. So what you can do? You can take help of the other vehicles, so you can receive the energy from them also. Or if needed, you can contribute energy to them. So this is what it is we are talking about, other connected vehicles, the energy exchange. Okay, so there are different some area concerns for the electric e-mobility is that traction drive. Okay, this is the traction drive is there, in which we talk about the mainly powertrain, in which you will be having onboard source, power modulator, and the motor. Okay, traction motor together with the controller, which is control system, which is required for the motion control. So if there is any fault, whether in the motor, whether in the inverter, or miss your power modulator, or in the control system, your system should be able to run continuously. This is the object. So whenever we are trying to ensure that mobility, even under the faulty condition, that comes under fault tolerant traction drive. Traction drive, you understand, then next comes the fault tolerant traction drive. Next is that onboard energy storage and management, because I explained to you that we have only onboard sources available, DC sources available. In some cases, like you will see that people are using ultra capacitor, flywheel, or some people will also use a photovoltaic panel on the roof. So because main source of energy is onboard DC, that is battery, so you must utilize that energy from the battery very efficiently. So the proper flow should be there. But what purpose, what you are using, when regeneration is taking place, where you should divert that energy, all those things should be in the control. So that comes under that onboard energy storage and management. Then next is that electric vehicle interface with the renewable and energy and grid. See, when we talk about the interface system, it's like basically we talk about the chargers, but here you will see that the charger is kept separate from here. Separate from that source. So when we talk about the grid, means basically you may have a charging station, and that charging station is meant to charge the vehicle through the battery charge. This is the main. Not necessarily, but the possibility is that charging station, if you are considering, is PV fed, so it may be assisted from the electric the grid also. So impact will be definitely there. So when you are going to charge the vehicle, you will be drawing immediately very large current. So there will be the drop in the bus voltage, DC bus voltage there. And then if there's a, you are getting energy from the grid also, AC grid also. So there will be the drop in the AC grid also. So all those things comes under that. We talk about the interface with the renewable energy and grid. Okay. Then chargers, of course, you need to submit the charge for receiving the energy from the charging station to the charging station or charging point to the vehicle. So the electrical circuital arrangement means, which is required to inject a particular current to charge the onboard battery, or to submit the charge to the onboard battery, is the charger. So we will discuss about this also. Then you can submit the charge by means of wires or without wires also. So that comes in here as a contactless energy exchange. Okay. Then next is that energy harness issue is also. Why we need energy harness? Because the moment we understand this harness, it means that we are talking about very small power. It is not like that power would be sufficient to power your to be delivered to the for the traction purpose. It is not possible here. So what type of energy we are talking about? Suppose that your vehicle is moving, suspension system is there. So maybe you will be connecting some piezoelectric transducers there. So from there you will be recovering the hand. Maybe at some point, let's say that motor is running, so temperature is going to rise. So we have studied seedback and filter effect also in past. So you can use thermoelectric generators to recover some of the portion of the energy. So you can use that energy. But the whatever you are using, that will be used to power the onboard gadgets only. The next and last term, like we are in e-mobility, we talk about the vehicular communication also. Vehicular communication. So let us see here. Electric vehicle definition. This earlier also I explained it so many times. Okay. So when we talk about the electric vehicle, but just one thing we have to understand that, or like we have to identify an electric vehicle, we have to see that what is the mean of delivery of final tractive power. If you are giving the final tractive power through this electric motor, okay, to electric motor, then it will be an electric. No matter from where you are receiving that energy. Of course, further you can classify it that we will be saying this particular vehicle is an electric vehicle if we are receiving energy from that source of electrical energy, okay, not from IC engine. So that section I will also explain you. So then the thing is that first we are going to deliver the final tractive power to the wheels. Through an electric motor, okay, this one, then it is an electric vehicle. Second thing, how you are going to deliver the tractive power, it is obvious, like you can have a single onboard motor or you can have multiple motor. Okay, so you can accordingly that you can directly deliver the tractive power to the wheel. I will explain this to you. Wheel tractive power directly to the wheel, or you will be using a differential gear. Okay. So we use differential gear when we are having only single motor, central motor. Okay, like sometimes we classify it as a single motor drive. You directly power transfer the power to the wheels. It means that we are talking about a multi-motor drive system. Okay, this like which each of the wheel tractor motor will be coupled directly. So what you will be doing that you will be receiving the tractive power, and how you are going to receive that energy. To get that power, it will be either fully contributed by the onboard DC source. So you have the battery, you are receiving whole of the energy from that one. If you are doing that one, then it is a pure electric vehicle. But if you are using a lower size IC engine also, lower size IC engine together with the battery, so it gets into it is termed as hybrid electric. Important is that if you see that here lower side IC engine is why? Because you are receiving a part of the energy from the onboard DC source. So the size of the IC engine is reduced. But it is very important that what is the overall objective of going for the electric vehicle? Okay. The objective is simply, you see that one here it is, you want to improve the performance and reduce the emission. The moment you improve the performance of the vehicle, so you are increasing the efficiency and other, like we say that other physical terms also, let's say. So what you are doing basically, consider efficiency. If you are increasing the efficiency means you are consuming less fuel. Okay. If you are consuming less fuel means you are reducing emissions. So let us see this case. Let us see this case. So here, just I want to explain. So first understand the definition. So one possibility is that so we have an IC engine. There's some problem. Okay, I will come back to this again. It appears that there's some problem with the thing. Okay. Suppose that this is IC engine. Oh. So consider that you are having an IC engine. Okay, this is an IC engine. And with this IC engine, you have, let's say the mechanical coupler is there here, mechanical coupler is here, and then this is connected with a differential generator, differential gear, and with this differential gear, the wheels are connected. So this arrangement, what you are seeing here, this particular one, this is a mechanical arrangement which is having more losses. So what you do, that you want to replace this section. And how we replace? You will be using an IC engine, okay? Then that IC engine will be coupled with a generator. So IC engine is there. This is coupled with a generator, okay? And then this generator is generating your electrical energy. Then you are having some power electronic arrangement. Okay, some power electronic arrangement is there, converter. And this is now delivering power to the motor. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm not writing that terms here. Okay, labels, because there's some problem with my pen. So a motor is here. Motor is here, and this motor is connected with your differential gear. Okay, here, this is differential gear, and like we have drawn before, the wheels. So this example is our case of electric vehicle. Because why? Because here we are using electric motor for the final tractive power. This is the case. Another thing is that if you want, you can bypass this section. Understood? You can bypass this section. You can bypass this section. In place of that, you can use your onboard batteries. Batteries. And this battery is going to power your motor. So this becomes pure electric vehicle. So first one is the IC engine fed electric vehicle. Second one is that battery fed electric vehicle. So whenever we are talking about electric vehicles, we in general, in common, always talk about this. Okay. Now, the different subsystems of an electric vehicle are what? This is our subsystems are traction system, supplies, then a traction system is there. Then you are having a supply system. In traction system, you will see that you have a voltage source inverter together with traction motor. So this is a traction system. But remember that, suppose that, like in this, in the present case, you see that here we are using a voltage source inverter. So the, why we are using this? Because the traction motor is AC type. It could be induction motor, it could be asynchronous. But if in this place you are using a DC motor, okay, DC motor, then this voltage source inverter will not be used. In place of this one, you will have to use a DC motor. Then you are having the supply system. Inside the supply system, you can have the sources like battery, fuel cell, photovoltaic panel. Okay, these are the energy sources. Then you can have power sources also, like ultra capacitor and flywheel. So, but please remember that one issue is there. These traction motors, these are designed for higher terminal voltage, and these battery sources are designed for lower terminal voltage. Understand why we keep the higher terminal voltage? Because if you keep the higher terminal voltage for the same power, the current will be lower, okay, as compared to the lower terminal voltage. So you are trying to reduce that copper losses here. But here, your source is able to deliver you that higher current, okay, even at the lower terminal voltage. So there's a big gap. Source voltage is low, but here the voltage is higher in the traction system. So what you need to do, either you connect the sources in series or you use some circuital arrangement, okay, to boost the voltage to the higher level. This is one case. And another thing is that, suppose that in your system, you are using multiple sources, for example, battery and ultra capacitor, or fuel cell and ultra capacitor, or battery and flywheel. So under such a situation, there's a necessity that you will have to use bidirectional converter for required power flow. Otherwise, you will not be able to do it. And rest, I will explain you once again. Okay. Okay. So like there are different possibilities of the sources, electric vehicles. Like these are the examples in which you see that only single sources are there. Means only batteries are being used. Okay, here battery is there, here battery is there, here battery is there, here also battery is here. And in this case also you see that you are having a battery. So all single sources are there. But like So let's just see, consider the case of this one or this one. Okay. So like here, this is the case of an electric car. So in this case, you can see that here, you're using two hub motors, like three-wheel motors, in which you can see here that the motor is with the wheel. Okay. If you remember the previous definition, then it was mentioned that you are directly power transferring the tractive power to the wheels or indirectly to the differential. So this is the direct transmission to the wheels, right? Power transmission. So here the wheel motor is there, and this is connected with the DC bus. You can see here DC bus. Okay. This the connection is there. This. At the here you are having the VRLA battery pack of 48 volts. Each four batteries are being used, and each battery is of 12. The capacity is 100 amps. Okay. Likewise, you can see that some of the examples, you can use multiple sources, such as like photovoltaic panel, then ultra capacitor. Just don't. Ultra capacitor is here. Ultra capacitor is here. And then battery is here. Ultra capacitor, you can see here. This is the ultra capacitor. This one is the battery. And on the top, you are having a photovoltaic panel. Similarly, you can use a photovoltaic panel and battery. Similarly, you can use your battery with fuel cell also. But here in this case, battery is removed, but you can use battery. In this fuel cell, you are having a hydrogen tank here, and then PEM fuel cell is there, and a DC to DC converter. Okay, this is the example. You can see here that typical layout. You can see here that that example what I with battery, okay, then ultra capacitor, and then photovoltaic panel. So here it is, battery, ultra capacitor, and photovoltaic panel. Then you can see that the battery is the main source of energy, and here whenever we are going to use the battery, we don't use any converters. Okay, we don't use here. But when you talk about the ultra capacitor or photovoltaic panels, there it is compulsory for us to use the DC to DC converters. Like when you are using ultra capacitor, you use bidirectional converter. When you use photovoltaic panel, you use only unidirectional converter, because in case of photovoltaic panel, it is not possible to submit back the energy. Okay, not possible to submit back the energy, but here you can have that bidirectional power. Okay, another thing is that suppose that the bus voltage here is 48 volt, this one is 48 volt here, then the ultra capacitor you have to use should be of 48. Okay, so of the same power, if it is 48 volt, this should be also 48 volt. Okay, this is the condition what it is there. Simple meaning is that, like, if you keep that the same volt, and let's say you are trying to accelerate, then what will happen? What will happen in this case, there will be a drop in the bus voltage. So when the drop in the bus voltage is there, then this capacitor will be acting like this ultra capacitor, and this arrangement, this particular arrangement, will be acting like a buck converter. So you will be able to submit the energy. And when the regeneration is taking place, it will be the reversal of the power. So this voltage will become higher than this capacitor voltage. So you will be able to submit back the energy to this. That's why, like, we need a bidirectional converter here. Okay, then there are some concerns with the electric vehicle, because now we are slowly moving towards the charging system. Just a moment. Huh? Hello. Okay. Yes. Okay. And so next is that, like, we talk about the concerns of electric vehicle. So, like, you will be seeing that we will, like, when we try to operate electric vehicle and we try to increase the more number of EVs, then the concerns what we are going to face is, one is environmental condition problems, like concerns issue, and the important issue is that it is going to lead to the localized pollution. How it is possible? So suppose that what happens that there's a particular area in which or a particular town is there, and it is declared that we will not gas it, and we will be running only electric vehicle. So what will happen, from where you are going to receive that energy? At present, the scenario is that in our country, mostly we consume the most portion of the energy what we are receiving electricity from the thermal power plants. Okay, so what is happening that the area where you are going to operate your electric vehicle, that will become, and if you increase more number of vehicles, then what will happen? That cleanliness is maintained, green, everything is okay. But what is the impact on the locations where the thermal power plants are available? Okay, you will see that because of the penetration of the more number of vehicles, that you need to run more and more ports to generate more electricity. So what is happening? That area where the these power plants are located, they will become polluted. Okay, more and more polluted. So this pollution, what we are talking about, is called localized pollution. Because the rest of the area you are making clean and green. The next the common problem people face is issue of range anxiety, longer charge time, life and cost of the battery, and impact of the vehicle on the vehicle charging on the grid. So all these issues, that range related issue, charging, longer charging time, the cost, and that impact on the grid, this comes under the category of operational concerns. So how it is? Because range anxiety, when we say, it means what? Why we are actually anxious about that? Because we have only onboard battery, okay, in which the charge is available. Suppose that the total range of the vehicle is 100 kilometers, and one day you are able to run for, let's say that you run 50 kilometers, and next day you need to run 60 kilometers, and today you forget to charge your vehicle. What will happen? You're not sure, like you will be having doubt that whether it is good to use these vehicles tomorrow or not, because you know that the charge available with the battery is not sufficient to run for 60 kilometers. So this is the issue. Okay. Then another issue is that suppose that your charge is completely finished. Okay. Like in this case, suppose that you are seeing that only you can run 50 kilometers, but you need to run for the 60 kilometers. So put that extra 10 kilometer of charge, you have to wait for some time. And if your battery is completely discharged, then you need to wait for 10 hours, 8 to 10 hours. Okay, so this is what is the longer charge, long charge charging time. The second thing is that the life of the battery. Problem is that you are having a battery, and always the investment in the battery is the one-time investment. It is not like that we are putting the petrol in our vehicle, where you have to, let's say that invest 2,000 rupees, 3,000 rupees, or sometime 150 rupees like this, depending upon how much kilometer you need to run. Okay, you're not investing whole of the amount at one time. But in case of electric vehicle, you almost invest one third of the cost of the vehicle at the beginning itself. Okay, and what is the life of the battery? If you're talking about the valve-regulated lead-acid battery, maybe your battery will last for 2 years. And lithium-ion batteries, it can go to 5 years, but the cost is also different. Longer life, you have to pay more. Shorter life, you have to pay less. But at the end, you know that again, you have to invest one third of the cost of the battery. Okay, this is the concern. Then impact of the vehicle charging on the grid. Just remember that these vehicle charging is not like your powering your house. In our house, how much current basically we need? 5 amperes to 15 amperes maximum, okay, for one house. But here in the case of electric vehicle, you see the requirement is 30 ampere, 50 ampere, 100 ampere, and in some cases more than that one also. So if you have 10 houses, which is requiring 10 ampere, and you're having one vehicle which is requiring 100 ampere, you can understand that one vehicle is equivalent to your 10 houses. Even in our house, when we turn on a heater, you will have seen that there's a drop in the response immediately. Okay. So such type of issue will be there definitely when you are connecting a vehicle to get charged from the grid. So immediately there will be the drop in the bus voltage, and to that grid, there are other loads connected. So when the drop is more, much and much more, then you will see that you need to make a charger whose input voltage variation should be wider. And if you make the wide variation of the input voltage, okay, then in that case, the cost of the charger is going to increase. So what if it's good? It is good that you regulate the grid voltage, even though when you are connecting this electric vehicle to get charged. This is the situation. So if the, you are ensuring the regulation of the bus, okay, maybe the DC bus, AC bus, whatever it is. So what will happen? The cost of the charge is going to, the cost of the charger, which is there, is going to reduce. And also you are not affecting the grid also because you're doing the regulation. So this is that one. But in overall, if you see that the main concern for a common people is that limited onboard charge, which is available with the electric vehicle. Okay, then what are the different possible solutions? If you don't do environment, in environmental condition, you can see that suppose that you don't want to pollute the environment. So what you can do? Then don't use that power from the thermal power station. Use all the places where you are not, you don't need to burn the coal. So one possible solution is that you like consider only that dedicated charging stations which are fed by the solar panels. Then under such a situation, let's suppose that a small town was there in which you was using electric vehicles, so make a charging station around that itself or near to that city itself, which would be solar power. So that solution is there. So under such a situation, you will be able to do, solve the problem of the localized pollution. Then operational concerns. Operational concerns are like when we talk about the different energy sources available, then we have to learn how to optimally utilize the onboard sources. Okay, optimal. We have to see the optimal utilization. Let's say when you are accelerating it. Okay, so when you are accelerating it, it's not good to use the energy from the battery. Better receive that peak energy from maybe ultra capacitor or flywheeler. Okay, when you are going to regenerate it, so you can submit definitely to the battery, but you have to ensure that it should not go beyond the allowed limit of the battery. So when you are submitting the energy, the battery terminal voltage is going to rise. Okay, so then after where you can submit? You can submit the energy to the ultra capacitors. Okay. Once that is over, let's say that then you can dissipate the rest of the energy to the rheostat. So among these three combinations, you have to make the optimal optimization of it. It is not like that you will be doing one by one everything. You have to think that parallelly how you are going to manage that flow of this energy. Whether you are talking about regeneration or when you are talking about the acceleration. Second thing, you have to talk about always higher energy sources, higher energy dense sources. I will explain about this one. When we talk about higher energy dense, it means that if the density is more, then we will be able to run our vehicle longer. Battery swapping, of course, this is one of the best solution. Okay, not right now. Simple reason is that if you talk about the battery swapping, means please remember that the 1/3 is the cost of the battery. So if your vehicle is 1 lakh rupees, 33,000 will be the cost of the battery. Okay, and if any service provider want to provide the service for to serve one vehicle, we will have to consider three batteries: one in the vehicle, second one is getting charged, and third one is ready to replace. Okay, so how much is the total cost? Again, 1 lakh rupees. So if you are creating an infrastructure of 10 vehicles, it will be 10 lakh rupees. Okay, 100 vehicles, 100 lakh rupees. And that too, again, you have to reinvest after 2 years, depending upon 2 years or 5 years, depending on which battery you're using. Because this battery, health of the battery also gets deteriorated once you're using it. Okay, so this is the concern. But how it could be a good solution? With the development of the low cost battery technology. When you will see that the cost of the battery is not one third, it will, let's say 1.5, 1/3, 1/10, or 1/20th of the cost of the vehicle. So under such a situation, this solution will be beneficial for the service provider. In any case, this solution is very good for the one who is driving the vehicle, customer, but not good for the service provider. It will be good for the service provider only when the low cost battery technology. Then another solution is that the solution for the longer vehicle. Because once you finish the charge, then you have to wait for 8 hours. So how to overcome that issue? To overcome that issue, you will have to consider the case of the fast charging. What is the fast charging? You submit the charge to the vehicle at higher rate. So when you higher rate means, suppose that C is the capacity of the battery and that is 100 AX, the normal charging is 10 ampere. So to make the charge, if suppose that you are giving 11 ampere, which is a fast charging, if you are giving 20 ampere or you are giving 50 ampere, so all these are fast charging. So depending upon at what rate and magnitude you are injecting the current, accordingly the rate of charging. This is what the fast charging. Then low cost battery technology solutions are there, like a zinc based battery. People are talking about iron based battery. Okay, sodium ion based battery. So all these are low cost battery technology will be there, and the range will be sufficiently large also. Then at last, operational solutions are, we have to address the power quality limitations. So we have the DC bus as well as we are having the AC bus. Okay, so when we are having the DC bus, we talk about the static equivalence, such as use of ultra capacitor. Okay. Maybe you can use a power battery. Maybe you can connect a flywheel at the DC bus. How you can consider the flywheel? Suppose that the DC bus is there, you are having a motor, and to this motor you connect a high inner series, okay? And this motor is connected with connected to the grid through a voltage sourcing motor, and then you have a control. So what is happening that during the normal operation, when the bus voltage is normal, at that time normal, what you are doing that you are receiving the energy from the bus, and then delivering, storing that energy into the disk. 1/2 j omega is getting stored. Now suppose that when you want to accelerate, what will happen? That the bus voltage of the vehicle is going to reduce. Okay, bus voltage is going to reduce. So when the bus voltage is reducing, then what will happen? That this disk will start delivering its energy to the bus. Okay. So what is happening? That because now you're receiving that energy which was stored in the disk of the flywheel, that is now it is getting submitted to the bus, and the bus voltage is regulated. First thing is that, and you are receiving, how it is regulated, because usually you are delivering that peak current which is required from the bus. So the bus dropping, voltage dropping not taking place. So this is the case, it could be there on with the onboard vehicle also. And same thing can be there with the charging stations. About the AC bus, you can use that dynamic voltage restorers, like some of the concepts of like STATCOM devices or other solutions at the AC bus side to regulate the AC bus voltage. So if you are regulating AC bus voltage, automatically you will be regulating the DC bus voltage. So these are like some power quality related solutions which we have to consider. Okay, then let's talk about the onboard energy management, because when we talk about the charging, so we talk about the energy management. So we have the onboard energy management, and we have also offboard energy management. Okay. So in onboard energy management, important is that, if you remember that earlier I told that, that there are vehicles in which multiple sources are being used. So the sources were what? Battery, fuel cell, photovoltaic panel, ultra capacitor. So like if you are able to see this diagram here. Here you see that this diagram. So this example is given that hydrogen fuel cell is there and ultra capacitor is here. But you notice here this one. Okay. You notice this one. Okay. Specific power is mentioned and specific energy is mentioned. What is the difference between them? If suppose that this is like power density and this one is energy density, if the power is energy, consider energy density. If the energy density of a source is more, it means that it will be able to deliver you a nominal current for a longer duration of time. And that means you will be able to run your vehicle for a longer duration. Now, when the power density of the source is high, so it means that you will be able to deliver very high current, but for a very short duration, maybe 10 seconds, 20 seconds, like this, 30 seconds, not more than that. Okay. So this is the situation. So, but like if you consider the example of the existing sources, let's say that here hydrogen fuel cell is there, then lithium air batteries are even higher. Okay. So these sources are having very high energy density but low power density. So what will happen? You will be able to run the vehicle for a longer duration of time. But when the acceleration, etc. is needed, you are going to affect the life of the battery. Similarly, when you are having the power source, you will be able to deliver the energy at the time of peak current, at the time of acceleration, or you will be able to recover it very fast. But when it comes to the run the vehicle for longer duration, these type of sources will fail to do that. So what is good solution? In a your supply, in your system, onboard vehicle, or supply system, what we talked about, you must have the different sources. One is the energy source and another one is the power source. If you make the combination of these two, the operating point will be here. Okay, here it will be the point. So this point means what? You have a supply system which has the capability of delivering high current as well as high current for a longer duration, so nominal current for a longer duration of time, and very high current, almost around two times the nominal current for a very short duration of time. Okay, so performance is met. You have improved the performance of the onboard system. So you will be able to run your vehicle for the longer duration. This is the schematic where it is shown here. You are having a battery, fuel cell, or photovoltaic panel, and then you have an ultra capacitor with bi-lapse stopper. So this type of arrangement is called mixed supply system or mixed energy storage system. Okay, then what are the different possible configurations? You see that like when we talk about the battery, okay, we talk about the series connection of the battery. And there's also another possibility, like suppose that the bus voltage is 48 volt here. Okay, this is the, let's say that this one is the 48 volt here, so, and the both battery is what, 12 volt. So you have to connect four number of batteries in series. Okay, but in some cases people will think that no, we will not use like this one, rather we will use two batteries, each of 12 volts, so 24 volt is there, and then you will be making boosting it with the help of boost converter to 48 volt. It's 24 volt to 48 volt. So under such a situation, yes.
Sorry for interruption, but your slide is not changing, sir. We are not getting the updated slide. Are you on? Yes, sir.
Not changing.
Yes. Can you please confirm your slide number? Current slide number.
It is 12 number.
Well, okay. But right now we are viewing only 9th number.
Just a moment. Okay, just can you check the setting? Yeah.
Let me restart this, the sharing.
People can see your screen. You are able to see?
So right now it is disabled. I am not able to see your screen. Can you please share one screen? Yes. Okay. Yes. So right now you are on 11th number slide.
But I am not sharing my screen. Okay. Okay. You are able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
But I did not change any setting. The same as it was. Okay. In any case, so in the ninth slide, we were here. Okay. And so we were talking about the possible solutions, concerns of the electric vehicle, which I saw you. Then possible solutions I discussed with you, and then I was talking to you about onboard energy management. Okay. So when we talk about this battery, then basically we consider that batteries are series connected. Okay, series connected battery is considered. And but in case of battery, we never talk about boosting the battery voltage to the higher bus voltage, like 24 volt to 48. Simple reason is that if you want to have the same performance, like say, consider this case, okay? Like here, suppose that four batteries are connected of 12 volts. So here we are receiving 20 ampere, okay? And battery capacity is 100 ampere. So 100 divided by 20 will work. 5 hours, you will be able to run your vehicle for 5 hours. Now consider the second case. You have the, let's say that here, two batteries only connected. Okay, so 24 volt is there, and here it is 48 volt. So what is the current requirement here in this case? 20 ampere. Now, because you are boosting from 24 to 48, so two time boost is there. So what is the current here? It will be 40 ampere. So what is how much hour you can run? 100 divided 100 Ah battery is there, so 100 divided by 40, 2.5 hours. You see, half hours you can run the vehicle continuously. So what you have to do? You have to increase the Ah of the battery. But the moment you increase the Ah of the battery, its capacity of the battery, its weight also gets double. If you're making it double, two times higher. Okay, two times higher if you're making. And the weight is also going to increase, and volume is also going to increase. So you don't see any benefit with the power to weight. Then when we are going to use this boost converter, so we use such type of arrangement only to do those cases like the case of photovoltaic panel here you can see, or the case with the flywheel, fuel cells, where you see that we need to maintain a particular operating point here, maximum power point, or here operating point this way. Okay. So when the output characteristic of the source is varying in nature, then under such a situation, it is compulsory for us to use maybe a boost converter or a buck converter, what it is here, depending upon the input voltage. This is the situation. Okay, so this is an example, okay, where like I try to demonstrate like why we need to use this ultra capacity, okay, and how it is going to help us in extending the life of the battery. Important is that, okay, when we talk about the battery, okay, so it's life of the battery. So it is generally decided in terms of how many cycles it is there. So maybe like 600 cycles will be there, or 1000 cycles will be there. So if you are able to finish all of the cycle in 1 month by any arrangement, then you lose your battery in 1 month. Understand? If you are finishing this cycle in, let's say, 1 year, your battery will last for 1 year. So it depends how much cycle you're using. Now, what is the cycle? One complete charge and one complete discharge. Suppose that you're charging the battery, so it is SOC is increasing, right? One complete charge, and then you are using the battery, discharging it, so complete discharge. So this one complete charge and complete discharge is termed as one. But not necessary. Let's say suppose that you have charged your vehicle 100%, but you discharge it only 70%. Okay, so discharge is only 30%. So how much contribution of the discharge cycle is there? Only 30.3. So such points can be 3 times or more than 3 times to make one complete discharge. Understand? So by this way, you can extend the life of the, reduce the use of the cycles of the battery. Okay. Let us consider another case, how we can extend it. Let us consider this case, okay? Consider this case in which you are seeing here that you are having a battery and a traction system. In traction system, what is there? Traction motor together with voltage system. Okay. And forget about this case, this circuit. So this is the situation. So what will happen? You can see here. You can see here this one. This is the battery current, normal situation. Now, and this is the, this is I load is lower one. Okay, this is ultra capacitor. I load will be here and ultra capacitor will be here. So what is happening now? You need to accelerate your vehicle. So what will happen? The moment you need to accelerate, what will happen? You need more current. So the requirement of current is going to increase like this. So at that time, from where that current will come? You're not using any other circuit, then battery current is also going to. And once the acceleration is over, then the current will settle down. This current will go down. This will go down here. So this situation is done. Now, the situation is that, like, but here you have seen that one rise is there in the battery current, and then again, drop is there. So this is a portion of the ripple in the battery current. So life is going to get affected. So what we can do under such a situation, it is better that to assist this peak current, use ultra capacitor arrangement. Okay. And with this arrangement, you supply the current. So the current is rising. You see, ultra capacitor gives the current. Upper one, I told you that it's ultra capacitor. So it gives more current. Okay. So because it is moving more current, so what happens? You see that the battery, there's not like this, rather, the battery current is now more flat. It is more flat. So you reduce the ripple in the battery. Ripple means the portion of the charge and discharge cycle we are talking about. Okay. This will take place when you are accelerating, and this will take place when you are regenerating. So ultra capacitor system, battery ultra capacitor system helps us doing such a, means providing such a solution. And in this case, it is because we are not using you have reduced the ripples, so it is possible to extend the life of the battery. Okay, now let's go ahead. Now let's talk about the charging of the battery. As per the, you can define the charging of the battery as, it is the process of submission of charge to a battery by forcing current into it. Okay. You can, suppose that a battery voltage is 48 volt, battery is there. Okay. And what happens, because we have used it, so the battery voltage goes down to, let's say that 36. Then you can charge this vehicle. How you can do, you have to force the current to the battery. But how you can force it? Two ways are there. You apply the higher terminal voltage. Okay. Then current will be injected. Or you ensure that current control. And in that case, then you will be able to inject the current. Okay. This is the situation. But let's say suppose that terminal voltage is higher, but still you want to hold the current. So under such a situation, you will have to use the current control. And of course, to ensure that current injection to current control, you need to apply the higher voltage at the injection circuit side. Then definition of the fast charging is that injection of charging current into a battery to be charged at a rate higher than C by 10 is the normal. I explained to you that C is the capacity of the battery. And when it is 100 Ah, then if you are C by 10 is what, 10 ampere. So if you are charging the battery with a 10 ampere of current, then it is called normal charging. Okay. But if you are giving, let's say 1.1 C by 10, means 11 ampere. 1.5 C by 10 means 15 ampere, or 2 C by 10 means 20 ampere, like this one. So you are increasing that current. Okay. So this is what the fast charging is there, and how much fast charge, fastness is there in, that is called degree of fastness. And that depends upon K. K means it is 1.1, 1.2, 2, 3, 4, 5, like this. So if, let's say you're charging at 5 C by 10. Okay. So it is much faster than 1.1 C by 10. This is what degree of fastness is there. Okay. Then different charging levels are what? Like we have level 1, level 2, and level 3, depending upon the power charge. And level one charging, like generally we go for the 230 volt supply. Okay, 230 volt supply is there. So under such a situation, what will happen? That basically we go with the single phase supply. Okay, single phase supply will be there. And this can be at your home, and the power level will be, in this case, 1.4 to 2 kilowatt. Maybe 1.4 to 2 kilowatt. And the charging time, because see, suppose that the battery voltage terminal is fixed, battery terminal voltage is 48 volt. Okay. And then if it is 1.5, 4 kilowatt or 2 kilowatt, accordingly, what will happen? The current will be higher. The current which is injected is higher or lower. So depending upon whether you inject a high current or low current, the charging time can be 4 hours to 11 hours. Similarly, we can see that when we talk about the level 2, then you see that it can be a single phase supply or three phase supply. And such type of arrangement is generally preferred for public charging places. Okay. And where you need to have very large amount of power, let's say that 4 kilowatt to 20 kilowatt. And the, because again, you have increased the power, so the charging time is going to reduce, because we have increased the current to be injected. And level 3, it is for basic fast charging also. In this case, it is must for us that we have to use the three-phase supply. And this is the case of the charging station, basically. And the power can go up to 50 kilowatt. And because you can consider like when the 50 kilowatt power is there, so the charging time will be accordingly reduced, the same voltage level. So you can charge it from the 15 minutes to 1 hour time. Then what are the different means of charging? Okay, depending upon whether your let's say the charging station, this is the charging station. Okay, this is the charging station. Okay, and through the wire you are charging. Okay, and here without any contact you are charging. No wire is there in between the vehicle and the charger. Okay, so what happens that when both the charging point and the vehicle are stationary. Charging point and the vehicle are stationary, then it is called static charging. Understand? When any of them is moving, let's say that here it is what is moving, the vehicle itself is moving and the coil is fixed here. Okay, then it is called dynamic charging. Okay, so this dynamic charging can be inductive charging or capacitive charging. Inductive charging means what? That energy will be exchanged through the means of induction. Okay, and in capacitive charging, you will have ultra capacitor here inside the vehicle bus. Okay, and then pantograph will be there, and at the stoppage, this pantograph will go up and it will get connected with the top loop where the supply is there and it receives the energy in bulk. This is also like an example of flash charging. The bulk will receive a huge amount of energy to the vehicle. Where you are storing it, you are storing to the ultra capacitor, which slowly dissipates to the traction battery. Of course, control will be there, so you have to think for the control, how the control is implemented. So that will be a current control because you are regulating that how the current is going to discharge. Because these ultra capacitor have the capacity to give, let's say that nominal current is 100 amperes, so it can give you 200 amperes for a very short duration of time. But you don't take 200 amperes, understand? Can take the lower current. So under such a situation, it will be possible that you can run your vehicle for a bit longer duration of time. Okay, different types of chargings are constant current charging. Okay, then constant current and constant current. This is a constant current charging. You can see here that the current is constant. Okay, and then you have a constant voltage charging. And then another one is what? This is constant current and this one is constant voltage charging. So you have the CC constant current charging, CC charging, CV charging and CCC. Then other charging methods are like pulse charging. You give a high current, you give the charging current for some time and then stop it for some duration of time. And then again you start it. Okay? Then again you stop it. And then this is pulse charging. And reflex charging is that give the charging, make the charging for some time and then discharge for very, very short duration of time. Understand? It is just like when you make dal at your home, you try to stir it, okay, for the uniform distribution. So here the same thing is there. For the uniform distribution of heat, what you do that you make some arrangement of the stirring time. Basically, it has a relation with the chemistry of the system. Okay. But the benefits in this case, like here, like when you work with the CC or CB, there's always possibility of the temperature to be higher. Okay, you do not have any control over the temperature of the battery. Okay, but when we talk about the pulse charging, here we have a control over the battery temperature. Okay, I will explain you that portion also. Okay, so how it is helpful? Actually, the two cases are there at present in common. One is bulk regulated lead acid battery, and another one is lithium ion battery. In bulk regulated lead acid battery, we have the problem of the formation of the problem of sulfation is basically there. Okay, so when the sulfation is occurring in the battery, then what happens that its capacity reduces. But when you go for the pulse charging, it stops the formation of sulfation. Okay, so because what will happen that capacity of the battery will not reduce with that rate as it was without pulse charging. Then second case is that like in lithium ion batteries, what happens that if you keep on charging and discharging, slowly what will happen that dendrite formation is there, dendrite crystals are there. Those will be between the electrodes. Okay, so slowly you will find that the electrodes are getting sorted. So capacity is again reducing. So the issue of that formation of dendrites is addressed, can be addressed through reflux charging. Okay, then there are some constraints when you go for the fast charging. Okay. Because you have the solution of battery swapping, cost, you need high cost infrastructure. Then another solution is what? You can go for the fast charging. So, but here you see that the case of the fast charging. Okay, fast charging. Please observe here, the left side here, this one. Okay, what if you see here, you will be seeing that here we are talking about X. This is X is same that K was there. Okay, so when we say that 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So when we say 2, it means you are giving the current, which is injecting the current into the battery, which is 2 times higher than the normal current. 4 times higher, 6 times higher, 8 times higher, like this one. Problem is here. This is the situation what you are observing. Okay. Now, if you observe this another curve, this one is the this curve. Okay, this curve. The this curve. So when you increase the charging current, state SOC is also increasing. This is increasing. But the temperature is also increasing. Temperature of the battery is also increasing. Now, important is that you will find that the capacity of the battery. Temperature of the battery, okay. The temperature of the battery lies somewhere here, okay. Permissible, around maximum permissible temperature, 50 to 60 degrees, something around here. So if you are doing it 50 to 60 degrees Celsius, just go back here and see what is happening here, go back here, okay. Under such a situation, it is just a moment, I call, huh? Just a moment. Hello. Okay, so important is here, you please observe, you cannot charge your battery with more than, you see, around 3, okay, 3.5 something C by 10. It is not possible, because if you do this one, battery temperature is going to rise beyond 50 degrees Celsius. But by this time, how much you are able to charge here? You see, upside 40%, not more than that one. This is one concern. You have increased the charging current. What was the reason? Reason was that you want to submit more charge to the battery. But problem is that battery temperature increased. Okay. Now consider that. Suppose that this is the case, let's say, with the lead acid battery. Now in lithium ion battery, what happens? That you will see that this is not at this one. Thermal time constant of a lithium battery is much larger as compared to the lead acid battery. So you will see that the rise is there, but it is slowly. Okay. It is slowly rising. So you can say that this one is for the lithium ion battery and this one is for the lead acid battery, because the thermal time constant of the lithium ion battery is more than the lead acid battery. So it means that if you inject the same current to the battery, okay, to a battery, a lead acid battery and lithium ion battery, you will find that the temperature rise in the lithium ion battery is much lower as compared to the lithium ion lead acid battery. In another way, what you can say that to have the same temperature rise, let's say this 50 degrees Celsius, this one, okay, here, one is here and another one is here. You can see that one. To have the same temperature rise, you can inject lithium ion batteries with the larger current. So it is around, let's say that 6.5 something or 7. Say you can inject with 7 C by 10. You can inject 70 ampere of current, whereas in case of lithium ion battery, how much you can inject? It is around 3.5. So you can inject 35 ampere of current on. Understand? So this is the different thing. Now, because you are submitting more charge, so you can see that in the lithium ion battery, go upside here. How much? You can charge 80% with the same temperature, right? So this is benefit with the lithium ion battery. Okay, you are not making any temperature regulation at present. No. So this is good. And why such is happening? Why the thermal time constant of the lithium ion battery is higher? Because the battery which is having high specific capacity will have the higher thermal time constant than the battery which is having low specific heat capacity. Okay, so that's why you see that in case of lithium ion battery, it is possible to inject the current at higher C rate. So the C rates. Okay. Now, let us see this figure. We talk about that we are injecting the current, so SOC is increasing, temperature is increasing. But what is the impact on the life of the battery? Okay, you can see here. When you operate your battery at 60 degrees Celsius here you see 60 degrees Celsius, what is the life around? 1 year, around 1 year. And if you operate your battery at around, let's say that 30 degrees Celsius, maintain that 30 degrees, so what is the life here around? Around 42 months, more than 3 years. You can see here. So, what is the operating temperature that decides the life of the battery? Okay. See, when you are doing the traction, when you are running your vehicle, you cannot do anything. Definitely, because we discharge the current at much higher rate. Okay, so the battery temperature is right. Only thing you can do that you can provide a cooling arrangement. So, with the help of cooling arrangement, you can solve that issue. You can ensure that regulation of the temperature. But when you are charging it, again you can use the cooling arrangement but charging process is in your hand. Okay, because it is in your hand, so what will happen that you will be able to regulate it at 30 degree, 40 degree, 50 degree. And so the life of the battery, which is getting affected due to the charging, rise in the temperature during the charging, can be controlled with the temperature regulated charging. Okay. Charge the battery, temperature regulation. And these two can be done through the cooling arrangement and then false charging method, false auto-reflex charging. Let's see, go ahead. Okay, so here I try to explain that temperature regulated charging. Yeah, suppose that you give that charging current continuously here. Okay, let's say that you are charging the current continuously. This is the continuous current you are giving. Okay, so what will happen? The battery temperature is going to rise from here. This is going to rise. And it will reach to the steady state value. Okay. Thermal equilibrium is established, you can see. Now, but our objective is not this, because definitely this temperature will be higher. And we have seen that if the higher operating temperature is there, life of the battery will get up. So what we can do? What we can do here? We will monitor the temperature and we will see that when the battery temperature is rising here, when it is rising and when just to a set maximum value here, you see, then we'll stop charging. Stop charging. And so what will happen? The battery temperature will start falling. And when it reaches to a minimum level, it start again charging. Okay, so its temperature will again start. Start charging. It will start again. Right. Okay, so by this, what is happening in steady state? This will go down. So you are regulating the battery temperature here to this average value. Same thing is here in case of reflex charging mode. You give high current, then you discharge it for a very short duration of time and again you charge it. So here also, if you don't do this, battery temperature will be higher. If you do this one, it will be regulated. It will be regulated. It will be regulated. So we have to think how we can. But when we do the temperature regulation, there is some concern. Okay. So I just want to explain you that portion. Okay. So here you are seeing the multiple curves. One is this one. Okay. When you see that temperature is rising. Here temperature is rising, this is rising, and it is now setting to the steady state value. But in other cases, you are saying that it is getting regulated. Temperature is getting regulated. Temperature is getting regulated in these cases. temperature is getting regulated. Okay, it is getting regulated and it is getting regulated. So why this is happening? First, we have to understand. So in this case, like what happens that this is the test what we have carried out it on 26 AH battery. Okay, 26 AH battery. So divided by 10, how much it will be? 2.6. So when you are giving the normal current, 2.6 ampere, so what happens that battery temperature will rise and it will go to the steady state value. But remember that we have set our temperature maximum to 30 degrees Celsius. Where it is rising to 27. So no temperature regulation is required. If you keep on increasing this current, okay, this current will definitely increase. Okay, this will increase, it will settle down. It will increase and it will settle down. It will remain unregulated. Why? Because the set reference maximum temperature is here, 30 degrees Celsius. It is here at this level. So it will remain regulated. So what is happening? With the increase in current, okay, temperature is rising, but it is not going beyond the set maximum. So what will happen? With the increase in current, we are increasing the submission of charge. You can see here on this figure, this one. We are increasing the submission of charge with the increasing charging current. Okay. Now, but what happens? This cannot go to a longer like a K value. Why? Because if you are increasing the K value, what is happening? Temperature is rising. This will rise and a time will come that it will reach this maximum level. Because it reaches the maximum level, you have to apply now temperature regulation. So what happens that it stops charging. So temperature, battery temperature reduces. It when it reaches the minimum value again, you start charging. So this is a pulse charging. And same thing is that you are increasing the current. But remember that when you are increasing the current, you can observe this width. Okay, please observe these two widths. These two widths, you observe. So width of the charging is getting reduced. Understand? So when the width is getting reduced in the for the same duration time, total permitted charge in what is going to reduce. So here you see that this starts reducing. It is reducing. I hope you understand. So accordingly, we have decided it that there are three regions of operation, A, B, and C. A is what? When the temperature regulation is not there. Means you are injecting the current, higher current, but the current is not that much sufficient to raise the battery temperature to the higher limit or set maximum limit. Okay. Then B is the temperature regulation, B and C. Here, what happens that when you are increasing the current, now the temperature regulation is taking place. So you need to reduce the width of the charging pulse depending upon how much the current is getting injected. Accordingly, the width will be there. Like here, 4.55 ampere was there, and here 7.5 ampere is there. Okay. So in the 7.5, width is lesser. So total charge submitted is also lesser. Understand? So this region C is that where the charge submitted is less than C by 10. Understand? Less than C by 10. Then it is C, otherwise this. So what we do that we try to operate always on the boundary of this one. Here, temperature regulation and regulation. So it is under our hand, and here it is possible to submit the maximum possible charge. Then we are having, let's discuss how to do this fast charging. Please observe these curves. This was the first one. If you increase the temperature reference, what will happen? You will be able to submit more current. Okay. More current. If you increase the more temperature, you will be able to submit more current. More current. So what happens? And where we are operating, we are operating at the boundary. Okay. So what it was slow charging earlier, now we come. Now in this case, what will happen? This will be faster charging as compared to this temperature unregulated charging at the lower temperature. By this way, what is happening that you are increasing the magnitude of the charge which is submitted. If you do like this, you will see that you will be able to charge in 4 hours, approximately 4 hours in battery, lead acid battery. And temperature is in your control. What is the benefit? It it is good to see here. Good to see here. To make a just a comparison, what we have done, that we have compared with a fast charging and CCCV charging. What was the CCCV charging? This one. This is particularly followed. We tried to make it charging up to 80 to 90%, 94, 95%, and then after we apply the constant voltage charging. Okay, this is CCCV charging. And so we are comparing this one with this pulse charging, TRS, the generation. So what the observation is there, you can see that then you have to fix something. Otherwise, you cannot make the cutoff because so many things are there. Like, so we assume that both the strategy, constant current charging, okay. Just a minute. Here you can see this one. This is the constant current charging. And when it reaches to a limit level, here we have assumed 98%, and then it reduces. Okay, CV charging. And then upper one is the pulse charging. So, what is the observation you can see? Both reaches the same SOC level at the same time, and then positive voltage is applied. Both the case. So, if you see the state of health of the battery, because the temperature regulation is maintained, so state of health is much better as compared to the CCC charge. There's a difference. About the temperature regulation, you can observe here. With the CCCV, as I explained you, that always battery will operate at a higher temperature. So it is operating at higher temperature, it is 53 degrees Celsius. And whereas in case of temperature charging, what is happening in the first charging, it is regulated at 37 degrees Celsius. Okay. It is regulated with the average value of 37 degrees. Okay. Yes, it is regulated 37 degrees Celsius. Okay. So operating temperature is low in case of that pulse charging. So what you have on how much it is 37 degrees and maximum it is 53 degrees. So I just have shown you the two plots there. Just a moment. Will not be discussing about the wireless charging. Yes, this one. See. In one case, you are operating here 37 degree. You are operating around here. Okay. So you can see here around 30 months. And in another case, you are operating here around this one. It is around 1 year. Something like this. So what happens that when you are ensuring that the charging, which is regulated, temperature regulated, it is possible that you can see the expected life of the battery is extended almost doubles. You can see that it is around 24 months. Okay. 30 months means like two years, you can say. And here it was lasting in 1 year. You can double the life just by applying the temperature regulation. That's why with the batteries, it is very important that you must ensure that temperature regulation, maybe put the air cooling or maybe some like liquid cooling, we have to follow. And then cycles, number of cycles, you can see this one. If you ensure the temperature regulation here, you will be able to see that here, that cycle is extended. Whereas in this case, the life cycle is only 4,000 and in this case, it is 8,000. You can double the life number of cycles also. These are the benefits of the temperature regulation. Okay. Sir, Mohan sir. Mohan sir. Sir, are you there?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Shall we continue or we just start the discussion? Because we have just 30 minutes and it is better to like take the questions of the audience so that it will
start the discussion.
Okay, so you can ask the questions.
Yes, sir.
It will be better, like to address the questions. Otherwise, there are so many things we can continue for a long duration.
Okay, so one participant asked question. With PV panel, when we use DC to DC boost converter, then capacitor at the load and will get charged, and at the certain moment, load voltage will get higher than the supply voltage, right? Mm-hmm. And then question mark, in this case, energy will flow from load end to source end. That means bidirectional energy flow is possible. Rituja is asked this question, sir. This is the one participant.
Okay, now definitely this is possible. And that's why there is a need of the regulation of the bus voltage. Okay, I try to explain you.
Okay.
I will be able to write with my pen because my pen is not working. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, so let us consider. Just a moment. So I explain you. Suppose that what is saying, suppose that this is a source. Okay. We are making a source here. This is the source we are making. Consider that this is AC source. And then what we are doing, here we are having rectifiers. Okay. Of course, we are having a I'm drawing it with the mouse, so definitely the diagram will not be good. FC rectifier, let's consider. Let's say that here we are using some filter circuit. So I'm making here FC. And with this, we made a DC bus. Okay? We made a DC bus. Now, what is happening? Let's say I'm considering with the case of charging station. Same thing will be with the case of vehicle also, where the deceleration will take place. Instead. So what is happening for the timing? Let's say that you are charging a vehicle. Okay, so many vehicles are being charged. So many vehicles are being charged. Okay. This is it. So what will happen in this case? At present, you are drawing very high current. Understand? Very high current you are drawing. So immediately when you disconnect the charge. So what will happen? Where this current will go? So because you have immediately disconnected, so immediately this bus voltage will rise. This just bus voltage is going to rise. Okay, and so you have to bypass this energy. So maybe like how you can bypass it, maybe like let's say that the ultra capacitor element. Okay, and then in this case you have I'm just drawing the diagram of a bidirectional converter. One box I have. Ultra capacitor from here, you have submitted it. So because the bus voltage is increasing, so this side voltage is increased. So what you do, you will start operating this bidirectional converter and it will submit back the energy to the ultra capacitor. So because you have recovered this energy, so the bus voltage will get regulated. Okay. Let us consider for the onboard traction. What is happening that we are having, let's say, a battery. A battery is there. Here we are having a traction system. ESI is here. ESI is here. And then you are having a, let's say that motor is there. Now what you have done, you started slowing down the speed. So regeneration will take place. The current is going to increase here. The reverse direction, why? Because the load voltage is higher than the supply voltage. Okay, supply voltage. So submission of energy will be there. Now, but here also what we do, that we don't try to submit the whole of the energy to the battery. Rather, we try to use some ultra capacitor element, UC element. Okay. This time I'm drawing this diagram properly because maybe someone. That's why. Huh? So. Just a the let's say that this is UC. Ultra capacitor, then you have inductor, and then you have the switches, two switches. Then you have a filter capacitor. Yeah. You have filter capacitor. And then we have connected it one way at this place, and another one is this place. So this also acts like a boost converter. This is UC. So here it submits the, what you will do, that the moment you want to make the recovery regeneration, you will not submit here. I explained to you why we don't submit, because the moment you start submitting, this voltage is going to rise. And if this voltage is, let's say, 48 volt, you cannot go beyond 56 volt. So what you have to do, you have to bypass this energy then after to this ultra capacitor. Diodes are there. This one. So this will submit the energy here. This will submit the energy. So what will happen? Whatever the increase in the voltage, now you are bypassing that excess energy to the ultra capacitor. So the voltage of this ultra capacitor will increase. So, but in any case, what will happen? The voltage of this DC voltage will be always regulated. Okay. I hope I am able to answer you. Maybe like you would also think that why I am considering this one. You can consider this also. Okay. This also. This also. Okay. This also. Okay. This is the capacitor, filter capacitor. And then here is your traction system. So I'm making here VSI, huh? This is VSI, and then here you are now powering to the motor. So whenever you are going to decelerate, what will happen? This voltage will be higher, and then this side voltage will be lower. So recovery will take place. So you can submit back to the battery. And when you are accelerating it, understand, when you are going to accelerate it, what will happen? That there will be a drop in this particular voltage. So you can submit the energy like that. But that regulation of the bus voltage problem, like recovery, etc., this is always done with this parallel arrangement. Just to increase the life of this battery. Okay, but next question can you ask?
Yes, sir. So next question is, how much kilometers can the electrical vehicle go in how much units, and after discharge there a backup for it and as well as weight?
I did not understand.
Yes sir, question is, how much kilometers can the electrical vehicle go in the
okay, I explained. So the question is that how much kilometer a vehicle can go. So see, suppose that there's a vehicle, let's say that this is a vehicle which has to run either on ramp or in a flat surface or whatever it is. It can go on the ramp, it can run on the flat vehicle. So accordingly, you make the sizing of the motor which is going to be used with the vehicle, because you have to consider that how much person you have to carry. Okay. What is the total weight? What is the like opposition? What your vehicle has to overcome? This tractive load. Understand? Tractive motor. You calculate that one, and accordingly you size the motor. So let us consider that you have sized the motor accordingly. So this is the motor. Okay. So accordingly you will be selecting. Let's say inverter is there. VSI is there. VSI is there. And then what is happening, that you are having. Sorry for my diagrams, because I'm drawing it with the help of my mouse. Okay, then you have your onboard batteries. Now, the question is that how much kilometer this motor can run. So let us consider that this traction system, so that is decided by how much current is there, requirement of the motor is there, this traction system, and how much is the capacity of the battery. Let's say that this is the, this traction system, okay, TS, I explained you before, needs 20 ampere of current to run. Okay, only 20 ampere of current. And then this battery is of, let's say that 100 Ah, understand? So this 100 Ah, what happens, ampere hour, okay? And you are drawing what? 20 ampere. So how many durations you can run your vehicle? 100 divided by 20 equal to 5 hours. 5 hours you will be able to run your vehicle. Let's say that with this 20 ampere, there will be some corresponding torque of the machine. And with that torque, okay, you will be able to run your vehicle, let's say at 50 kilometer per hour. It's an example I'm giving you, huh? 50 kilometers per hour. So in 5 meters, how many kilometers you can run continuously? 250 kilometers. Understand? So your range will be 250 kilometers. Understand? Suppose that here, in place of 100 Ah, you just use a 50 Ah battery. Understand? So what will be the range? It will be just half. So you will be able to run your vehicle at 125 kilometers. You consider only 25 Ah battery. Okay, so it will be just half of that one, 62.5 kilometers. So Ah of the battery plays a very important role, okay, because you already have sized your machine and the current requirement is fixed. That's it. It is not necessary that the 100 Ah battery in your case is giving you 250 kilometers. So in another vehicle also it will give you 250 kilometers. No, let's say that another vehicle requires 100 ampere current. So what is that? The vehicle can run only 1 hour. And so for 50 kilometer per hour, you will be able to go only 50 kilometer. So it depends upon what is the current required by the motor and what is the capacity, this current required by the traction system. Okay. Okay. And what is the capacity of the battery? Depending upon that, we decide the range of the vehicle. I hope it is clear.
Yes, sir. Next question is, can ultra capacitor eliminate the battery of electrical vehicle in future?
No, definitely not, because the you see that the capacity, ultra capacitor is a power source. Okay, so it is like it has a capability of delivering very high current for a very short duration of time, and that duration is not more than 1 minute. Understand? So because of this one, we cannot use it as a replacement of the battery. But yes, some concepts are coming in which this hybrid batteries are being used. Hybrid battery means what? Like you have seen that diagram in which one battery was there and ultra capacitor was there. So the two combinations are there together. Understand? So such type of combination can be a solution.
Okay, so
it
next
use
question.
Ultra capacitor only for peak.
So next question is, what is inner and outer control loop in charging? Please explain.
Inner and outer control loop is what? When you talk about CC and CV charging, we have to use the separate. I hope I will be able to clarify. Okay. See, just a moment. Huh? 1 second, I go here. Suppose that this is a battery. A battery is there and we have to charge it. So let me draw the diagram. So let's say that this is you want to make a constant current charge, you know? So I reference, and then you have a plus minus, you take the I feedback. Okay, I feedback is there. Then you are having the PI controller. And then regulation is there, and then you have delta reference. Okay, delta reference, and this is given to the PWM modulator minus plus, we make it, and then you have the comparator like this. Huh? And what you are going to get is delta. Let us consider that you have a charger, understand? And for the time being, we are considering that this charger is a buck converter. And this is what? This is the bus voltage where the charger is connected. This is bus voltage of the charging station. And then you are having a charger, and then a filter. and then again a filter inductor. This is the battery to be charged. So what you are doing, you are sensing this current. Okay, this is the current. So this is your I feedback, what you have seen here. Understand? So when you, the moment, and this is the switch which is going to be operated. So what you are doing, that you have set some charging current reference, like you want that this much of current should be injected into the battery. Okay, and then you have taken the feedback, and then this is the situation. And so what is happening to this switch, this is a reference feedback, that PI controller is there, duty reference you are deciding, then duty PWM is generated. Okay, and with this PWM pulses, you give these pulses to this driver circuit of the switch, okay, driver circuitry of this switch. So accordingly, you are able to charge your battery. Same thing you can do when you need a CV charging, understand? So you sense the battery voltage, understand? You sense the battery voltage. So you will be having, just a minute. Consider this diagram. Please consider that, huh? And then here in case of this, now you are setting V reference. V reference means how much voltage you want to maintain across the battery. Okay. And then here, let us consider that this is feedback. And so what will happen? The duty ratio, what it was generated here, that is delta PWM current. Okay. And here it is generated delta PWM voltage. Understand? So now what we will be doing, that whenever you decide the pattern, you know that you have this constant current charging. This is time and this is current. So if you only want CC charging, CC charging, you will be using only this loop. If you want that you need to have CV charging, CV charging, okay, then you will be using what? You will be maintaining that voltage. Okay, this is V battery. Understand? CV charging. This is called constant voltage charging. But there's a possibility that you want both. Understand? So constant current charging will be there, and after that, what will happen? That the voltage will rise, and then you maintain your constant voltage. So this is your CC charging, and this one is your CV charging. Okay, and by that time, current is going to drop down here. Okay. So when you are doing this, then you have to estimate the SOC of the battery. And depending upon, let's say that we say that once SOC reaches to 85%, okay, and you are reaching SOC 85% here, let's say. So what you have to do, earlier you were working with this current charging, okay, constant current charging. Now because SOC is reached to that level, so now you move from the CC charging to CV charging. So earlier you were giving the delta PWM I to this switch, now you will give what? You will give delta PWM voltage to the switch. Understand? To ensure that switch. So this is what it is, the two loop charging, basically what you can say. This is a parallel, okay? This is basically a parallel arrangement. I hope I am able to clarify you. Okay, next question.
Next question is swapping of battery is safe for vehicles?
Yes, because now battery is not yours, battery is of service provider. So it is a headache of the service provider, not yours.
And next question is how to reduce weight of the battery?
See, Rajiv, you cannot reduce the battery. It is the task of that chemical engineers who are doing the work. But the thing is that it depends which chemistry you are using. Lead, it is heavy. Can see, if you look onto the periodic table, you find that you have a sodium, okay, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, like this one. So the moment, suppose the lithium is the lightest you can consider, then accordingly, if you go around the periodic table, the situation will be there. Let's say that people use a zinc-based battery, okay, then iron-based battery. So if you go down, the weight of the battery is definitely going to increase, but the weight of the metal is increasing. So the lightweight material you use, let's say that lithium, sodium, all those things, the weight will be lighter.
Next, Aarti is asking which converter is more suitable for HEV, buck boost or buck boost converter, or why?
See, it depends. I explained you that what you are going to use in hybrid vehicle. Suppose that you are using only, let's say, that photovoltaic panel. You cannot submit back the energy to the photovoltaic panel. So you have to use only unidirectional converter. Another thing is that important is that if you are going to mount a photovoltaic panel, how much is the voltage there? It's like with that photovoltaic panel, the space is very less. So what will happen? That you, let's say that you are able to mount only one panel, so voltage is less. So you have to use that boost converter. Yeah, understand. Right. But let's say the output of the photovoltaic panel is let's say 35 volt, and you are using a motor which is just 12 volts. You have to use the bus. So it depends upon what is the bus voltage is there, and accordingly you have to use buck boost converter or something. And like your ultra capacitor is there, there you have to use buck boost converter. This bi-directional converter is needed.
And another participant, Ramesh, is asking what are the research opportunity in EVs, electrical vehicles, for an electrical engineer?
See, like if you see that major component is electrical, you have the motor, you have the converter, okay? And basically your batteries are there, so you are going to light the battery. If you say, you talk about the energy management, everything is like what we can do, electrical engineer can do. Okay, leave that communication related issues and all those things for the electronics engineer. Understand? Then let's say that data analysis and all those things computer people can do. Structural analysis, etc., can be done by the mechanical people, thermal analysis and everything. But for the major role in case of electric vehicle is of an electrical engineer, where we need to work with the power electronics, we have to work with the energy management, we have to work with the like a control of the that power electronic converter which is there to ensure your mobility of the vehicle. So most important role is there for the power engineer, basically power electronics engineer, power electronics and drive engineer. You can also, those who are power system people, they can work for that pricing related issue, then grid stability related issue for the charging station. So power system have people have the for great opportunity on outboard energy management, and control engineer has a great opportunity on onboard energy management. Electrical energy engineer has opportunity on working with the battery management system and powertrain.
Okay. Sue Kumar Chaudhary are asking how to calculate the rating of energy storage like battery and ultra capacitor.
See, basically we are application engineers. We don't need to calculate that what is the capacity of the battery. Rather, we have to see that how much AH capacity battery we need. Understand? You can decide, you can size your machine, like vehicle. Accordingly, you know that which size motor is used and what is your current requirement. This is done, and then you have to ask the question that how much kilometer you want to run with this vehicle. Understand? So suppose that you say that like I want to run only say 50 kilometer, and that then you will see that okay, then what is the current which is required by your motor here? Then you see that okay, that the requirement is only let's say the 25 ampere. And then you see that in practice, how much kilometer per hour your vehicle is running continuously. Understand? So you know that you have to run, let's say, 25 kilometer per hour. Understand? You want a range of 50 kilometer only. So what should be the AH of the battery? Let's say that to run at a 25 kilometer per hour, you need only, let's say, the 20 ampere of current. For an example, earlier I said more, let's say that 20 ampere of current. So if you are with 20 ampere of current, you are able to run for the 25, let's say that 25 kilometer, for example. So if let's say you need to run 40 kilometer, 50 kilometer, so continuously you should be able to draw that much of current, 20 ampere continuously for 2 hours. So from where you will use it, that one. So let's say that we use a 50 AH battery, and you are drawing 20 ampere of current, so 2.5 hour continuously you can run. So still you have the charge. So accordingly you have to decide, but you will be deciding that no, 50 kilometer to go and 50 kilometer come back. So accordingly you have to decide that how much AH should be there. You have to double the AH. So by this way you have to calculate. Rough calculation is like this, and more accurate calculation will be depending upon, it is not like the continuous, maybe you will be accelerating for some time. Okay, when you are accelerating you are drawing double the current. In place of 20 ampere, you are drawing 40 ampere of current for, let's say that 10 seconds, and let's say that 100 times you are accelerating it. So 10 seconds multiplied by 100 seconds, so 1000 seconds are there, so divided by 60. Understand? So by this way you have to imagine whole of the driving cycle, and then accordingly you can calculate more accurately what should be the AH of the battery. But thumb rule what I explained you can follow. Okay, next question.
Next question, Akshay Badgujar, how can we calculate R and C value for pre-charging circuit?
R and C for the pre-charging circuit.
R and C, sir.
Now, which pre-charging you want? You want to pre-charge the battery or what?
Sir, here is not mentioning.
Okay, you can only unmute him so that I can ask.
Unmute.
Ask him to unmute himself.
Participants can, sir, not possible for. They can ask in chat box.
Okay. See, generally pre-charging circuit etc. are basically used, let's say, suppose that you have a grid, understand, and then you have a PFC rectifier, or maybe let's say that VNR rectifier arrangement is there, first thing is that under such a situation, or maybe in some cases like multi-level converter case also, there also we need pre-charging circuit, like where that it is capacitor clamp, that capacitor, okay, flying capacitor arrangement is there, so you have to pre-charge it. So size, decision of R and C of the pre-charge circuit is decided by the circuit time constraints. Let's suppose that you have a DC bus, understand, let's say battery is there, and then you have a converter, and at the DC link you are having let's say we have a capacitor bank there. So you want to make it pre-charge. So you, for that purpose also you can use a pre-charging circuit. Understand? So to make that capacitor pre-charge, we do pre-charge to avoid that inverse current. Understand? So you have to consider that this is something that you just turn on your vehicle. So how much time is available? So that RC time constant you have to calculate. Understand? So within that time, your bus voltage should reach to that level. Generally, we do like what we do that when vehicle is not in use. Sometimes some people try to discharge that.
Yes.
Okay. So at that time, the pre-charge are put in. Basically, circuit time constant is important.
Okay. Sir, all question is and finished, sir. Maybe participants are get proper answer, hopefully.
I hope they can, otherwise they can also contact me. You can share my email ID with them.
I just type
so that they will be able to see it. I said my, okay, sorry, it goes to organizers and panelists. I think I have to send to all. No, it is not being sent on. You can share with I shared, yes, my email ID.
Yes, sir, I will share all participants with your email ID, sir. I would like to thank today's speaker, Dr. Ritesh Kumar Keshri, sir, for this resourceful session. I am sure participants have found its very interesting and incredible use. I will send a feedback link after completing this sessions, there will be few questions for today session. Please fill it. Hope you all had a great learning day. See you all tomorrow, Sarf, at 12 noon for the next session. And again, thank you, sir, for your giving the wonderful informations related to electrical vehicles charging systems. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, madam. Thank you. Thank you, madam.